And the videos about this topic are going to be really exciting. An old slot card racetrack is brought back to life. We are building a cool web counter that you can use to control and monitor the race. For slot cars racing, you need a good lap counter. It should have start-stop lights, controls and timers to measure the lap times, best lap times, average lap times, total time and average speed. Today I'm explaining the development of my project from the idea to the first tests of the prototype. There will be more videos about this later, because of course we need a cool case design and we also need to see how the new lap counter works together with the slot car racetrack. My idea is to control and display the results using an internet browser. This trick gives me sufficient display space, which I can design myself using HTML. And I can use practically any device that supports a browser. I have to admit that the idea wasn't really easy for me to implement, especially on the software side. But I learned a lot from it and I want to share my findings with you on this channel together with that project. And guys, you know, subscribing to the channel doesn't cost you anything and it helps you and the channel. As said, the concept involves a browser to control the lap counter and to display all the results. Data transmission is realized via a local Wi-Fi network to which the ESP32 development board and the other devices are connected. I actually implemented all functions and a website on the local ESP32 board so that no data needs to go out to the internet. Optical sensors detect when a vehicle is passing. The red and green LEDs are indicating the status and the two relays are controlling the power supply of our slot cars. Optionally, you can even connect the ESP32 board directly to a computer via the USB interface and record the data of an entire racing event in a file. Formula One watching is a kindergarten compared to that. No, of course not, I'm just joking. You know, this is something for Excel freaks like me, and I will show you some Excel analytics occasionally. The hardware is actually simple to build, because almost everything we need is already integrated on a standard ESP32 development board. There we have all the digital connections we need, then there is the USB port and the Wi-Fi adapter, of which we can only see the onboard antenna here. Here is a tip. There is a variety of such boards on the market and they are all relatively inexpensive. I would always prefer a board with an antenna that is not integrated on the PCB. Separate antenna like this one are always achieving a better Wi-Fi range. I would even appreciate if the board had a connector for an external Wi-Fi antenna. Then we need two sensors that report when the slot cars are passing by. I used two relatively cheap infrared sensors here. You can even get several of these things for a few euros. Other sensors can be used here as well, for example acoustic or radar sensors. The two sensors are connected to the 3-volt power supply, ground and two digital inputs. I chose 150 ohms for the two serial resistors, resulting in a current of approximately 10 milliamperes for each of the LEDs. By the way, the two relays are optional. There is a variety of ready-to-use relay boards with optocouplers that ensure electrical insulation. I will briefly explain how to connect them in case you want to use them. With the relays, we can disconnect the slot car's power supply at this point. Please make sure that you are using relays with both active on and active off contacts. The reason for this is the following. When you interrupt the power supply, you also want to slow down the slot cars with dynamic braking. This is achieved by the second contact, with which we shortcut the motor's induction currents to ground when coasting. By the way, it makes sense to use the relay so that the power supply is switched on when it is not active. Then the slot car racetrack works normally when our lap counter is switched off. The code has become quite complicated, at least for my standards. We are reading the sensors, calculate the times and somehow send the values to our website. Then we have a website with HTML controls and JavaScript functions. And here I really have to give a big shout out to Kris. I hope I pronounced the name correctly. He published this method on his YouTube channel and it was a good basis for my project. In contrast to simple web servers that are only using website updates, this method gives you really short response times. This is particularly important for this project. So, thank you very much, Kris. You could actually fill 3 videos with the code, because there is a lot more to it than I initially thought. Here is an example of one of the problems that needed to be solved. When a vehicle is detected, a sensor usually delivers several signals because the vehicle does not have a homogeneous shape and color. The evaluation software needs to take this into account and must be able to deal with it. Otherwise, the counter would not count correctly. You can already see from the large number of variables that there must be comprehensive code. Don't worry, we just take a quick look at the main loop of the code. Okay, there is some logic to switch the LEDs and relays. Then, in addition to reading sensors, we can also use a race simulation. Simulation is extremely important in order to test the basic functions of the code in detail, because not all of these tests could be carried out with real slot cars. And, you know, testing and debugging usually takes much longer than developing the code. Next, we have the calculation of the times. At the end, we have to communicate with our website. Then we have the website here in a separate file. Guys, that's another 1000 lines added to the code, having already like 1300 lines. That's interesting, but let's talk about that in a separate video. This is what the user interface looks like when a racing simulation is running for test purposes. We start a short race with only 10 laps. This causes all traffic lights to turn from red to green and all timers to start working. We get, of course, the lap times. And the best lap times are displayed here. With each new best time, the color changes to yellow. I personally particularly like this feature. And then we have the average lap times, the total time and the average speed. On the right are the differences between the two vehicles. Below we have some additional information such as track length, the scale to the original vehicles, the Wi-Fi strength and the version number of the code. And when the race is over, the winner will of course get a trophy. For the next test I had to borrow toy cars from the neighborhood kids, which of course cost me a box of cookies. I'm testing a red tractor racing car and a black police car. And the latter is quite difficult for the infrared sensor to detect due to the black color. But anyway, both vehicles are reliably recognized. By the way, for the test I pulled a piece of shrink tubing over the diodes. In this way the influence of disturbing side light is reduced. In slow motion, you can see that the sensor actually produces multiple pulses while it detects the vehicle. Then we turn the lap counter so that we can see the start-stop lights in action. The operation runs quite smoothly and our website responds really quickly. That's how I wanted it. After testing and improving the prototype for ages, it runs very stable, and so I can publish the project. In the next step, we will take a closer look at the user interface and the code. Then, of course, we have to test the lap counter in a real racing situation. This will be great fun, and I'm already looking forward to it. And then I have to think about a cool design for the casing. What do you think about my design draft? Tell me in the comments. Now stay tuned and don't forget to support the channel. See you soon in the coming episodes.